Welcome to Mo Banshee's Lair. This show has been altered to conform with YouTube's rules on copyright. The music has been removed in some of the commercials. I hope you enjoy it, and God bless you and yours.
Toto? I have a feeling we're not in Kansas anymore.
Welcome to Mo Banshee's Lair, rocking your world.
The creeps were crawling out of the woodwork like a bad dream.
Well, come on in, girls. New wave, huh?
The hell happened?
It's your kind of case, Jones.
Murdoch thought I was washed up.
Last chance, Jones.
There's nothing like a murder to get you back on your feet. I needed a case. Needed it real bad.
I'm not a cop.
I'm not a hooker.
But what were you doing hitchhiking on Sunset?
Thought I'd visit a piss-poor pool hustler named Fast Eddie.
It's about that money I owe you, man. I ain't got it.
So relax!
No a good tooth, man?
The rat. Ex-con. Ex-dentist.
You the rat? I think this tooth belongs to a vampire.
You know any bloodsuckers in this town?
There'd be a lot of bloodsuckers in this town.
Any for real? Where do you go when you're looking for a vampire? I figured Hollywood Boulevard was a good place to start.
What do you want to know?
I'm looking for a vampire with one tooth, know any?
Come on in. I know what you want. We're vampires and we came to feed.
I don't know. This case I've got's driving me crazy. I got a couple dead in Hollywood. I've got this toothsome rat claims belongs to a vampire. And you know what the kicker is? This bite on my neck? I don't even know where it came from. I think it's the bite of a vampire.
There's no such thing as vampires, you know that.
I'm making a vampire movie. A lot of blood, a lot of sex, a lot of violence. I think you girls would be perfect for this.
What do we have to do?
You gotta take all your clothes off. You got to get naked.
And welcome to Mo Banshee's Lair. And you just listened to a promo for a movie that our friend... that is waiting, has made. And Greg Travis, welcome back to the lair.
Thank you, Gail. It's good to be back.
Yeah, it's got everything. It's got sex. It's got murder. It's got vampires. It's got, I mean, I got nothing
well,
but questions.
It's a gothic vampire detective film noir is the official title of it, called Dark Seduction. And we made it back in, well, I was like 25 years old, and it was like my first real feature to direct. And we made it back in 84 and 85 and just scraped together a few little investors and mostly our own resources and our own money. And it was a cool little film, but it never got finished. And so, you know, it got lost for a while and got misplaced, and things just were... you know, very difficult to try to pull it all together. Every time that I would go back and try to finish it, something would happen that would stop me dead in my tracks. Like a company would close that I would be working with on it or something, you know, like that. And I never could finish it. And so finally, I got the negative cutter who had all the work print and the negative had a stroke and disappeared. And so it took me a long time to track him down. And then I got the daughter to look for the film in his house, and she couldn't find it. And they tried two or three times, but they couldn't find it. And they looked in all through the garage, and it wasn't there. So I called my psychic, and I said, Tana, is this thing gone forever? Is it still there? Is it gone, or should I just forget about it? And she said, no, it's in a little cabinet in the corner of the garage. And that's where I begged the guy to go back and look one more time, and he did, and that's where it was.
Oh,
and
wow.
So, yeah, it was a pretty amazing story. So, yeah, I did a little documentary sort of explaining the backstory of this whole thing called 30 Years of Dark Seduction, and I haven't cut that together yet. We've got a few more interviews to do with it, but basically that tells the... We interview all the old actors, and we went back to all the locations, and we shot, you know, all the... You know, the locations, what they look like now as opposed to what they look like back then. There's even some signs like on the parking price where you can see a car pull away from a parking lot on Hollywood Boulevard where the parking is like $1.50.
Wow.
You know, all day for $1.50, you know, back in 84. So it's got a real period feel to it. And even though it's in the 80s, it kind of looks still like the 40s. And, it's a really, really cool little cult movie. And I'm very excited to be finally premiering it and showing it at the NUART.
Yeah, that's coming back. A couple of things I wanted to touch on with. But little films like these, and I don't want to call it a little film. It's an undertaking. But
yeah.
Films like this... are starting to be more and more popular. It's almost like back in the 70s and late 60s when you had those movies, you know, those B science fiction movies in mm-hmm. the 50s and stuff. They seem to be coming back again.
There is a lot of, that's one of the reasons I'm showing it at this particular theater is because it was one of the original midnight movie theaters. It was the first place they showed Rocky Horror Picture Show, and they had Eraserhead in there on a Friday night, and then also Pink Flamingos, and many, many other midnight movies went through there and showed for a long time, and there are about 50 or 60 theaters around the country that have both a Friday and Saturday night midnight movie.
Mm-hmm.
And so they rotate them different ones on Friday, but usually it's Rocky Horror on Saturday night.
Yep.
And so, you know, the Rocky Horror's been going on for 35, maybe 40 years, since 1975 is when it came out. And, it didn't have a very good theatrical release. Nobody really paid attention to it. But they were smart enough to try to get it going as a midnight movie, and it's since made over $100 million, you know, maybe more, as a midnight movie. So, you know, there's something to be said for, you know, getting together with your friends and, you know, maybe having a hit of pot and a little bit of drink. And, you know, getting together with your buddies and just going out and having a good old time watching some crazy movie that you don't have to worry about being real polite at. You can scream and yell and shout out things and just have fun, you know.
My granddaughter just took one of her friends to see it here in New Jersey. And she says, yeah, she's a virgin, my mom. She says she's never seen it. And I went, oh, boy, does she even know what she's in for? And they said, nope, we're bringing her in blind. She's going to be, you know. So I asked how it went. She says she loved it. You know, they dress up as characters, and then they get up in front of the screen while the movie is going, and they act it out and everything. And they have a blast. They just have a blast doing it. My kids were born in the 70s, you know, in the early 70s. So you're right. My daughter is 43 years old, you know.
Mm-hmm.
It's been going a long time. And now my granddaughter, who is his 20, is taking friends who have never even heard of it to it. You're right. And I love that theaters are doing that because it's, I don't know, it's introducing acting, I guess, to everybody. And you don't have to be a committed actor. You can just go out to Rocky, you know, Horror, and suddenly you're an actress in front of a screen, you know, and everybody's cheering you and screaming, you know?
Yeah, yeah. Well, I mean, it's a different avenue for a theatrical experience, you know, and I think as long as we're, you know, keeping the theatrical experience with film alive, that we're doing a good thing. Because, you know, I think it's good that people get out and do things together in a community, communal sort of way, because it's tribal, and we are a tribal people, you know.
Yeah.
We need to get together and, you know, have fun together and do different things together, besides just going to a bar and, you know, hanging out and drinking. There's other things to do out there that are a lot more fun.
Yeah, humans are pack animals, and they are also nomadic. You know, that's just the way we are, you know. If you've covered
It's also, we're very tribal, you know, and it kind of is reminiscent of getting around the campfire and listening to the chief tell the story about hunting the buffalo or hunting the big animal, or the hunters getting up and talking about the great hunt. I mean, that's really where entertainment came from, you know. And then the flickering of the light has been,
special effect.
It has been, attributed to the same effect as the flicker of the firelight, you know.
Mm-hmm.
So it's a group, it's the tribe sitting around the campfire listening to the story. And that's, you know, sort of a film is a modern version of that.
So let me ask you, Mark Redfield has started a whole vampire type of series, The Cult of Nosferatu, and his books are in the noir type of thing, you know, the Dashiell Hammett type of...
Oh, really? I didn't know that.
Yeah. So you did this back... You know, like 20 years ago, you've been working on this.
Thirty-some years ago.
Like they say, everything old is new again.
Mm-hmm.
You know, what made you think to go to a noir type of... and for those listening, it's black and white. It's the old detective, like a Humphrey Bogart type of deal.
There was a thing in the early 80s where the VHSs of all those old movies started coming out, and we had seen some of them on TV growing up, but we hadn't seen a lot of them. And so they started re-releasing all these old 40s and 50s film noir on VHS.
Yeah.
You know? And so I got into them. I was a film student, and so I was, you know, checking them out and kind of catching up on my film noir education. And it's just a genre that is very interesting. It's it's all about the seedy lowlife criminal element, and the ones in the 30s are okay, but the ones in the mid to 40s to mid 50s are really rather good, you know.
Mm-hmm.
And they've got a very unique style and a very specific style with the narration and the detective. And, you know, there's always a femme fatale and there's always a good girl that he should be with, but he likes the bad girl and he gets in trouble with her. And, you know, it's got that formula. And they're great-looking movies, too. They look fantastic with the lighting and the style in which they shot them. I just loved all that black and white photography, you know.
Who's your favorite director in film noir?
Well, I'm a big Orson Welles fan.
Yeah.
I love Orson. You know, he kind of did it bigger and better than anybody.
Mm-hmm.
And he even did his own film noir, which was Touch of Evil.
Right.
Where he played the Southern Sheriff, and Charlton Heston played the lawyer, Mexican lawyer. And so... you know, there was, you know, when those films were coming out on VHS, we hadn't really had a chance to study them, you know, because you would just go to an art house and see it on the big screen, you know, was about the only chance you had to see those films or every once in a while on TV. So mm-hmm. it was really fun to be able to look at them over and over again on VHS when they came out on tape. Yeah.
Yeah. Everybody equates him with Citizen Kane.
They do, but I mean, you know, Kane obviously is his masterpiece, which was somewhat commercial masterpiece, not very commercial when it came out, but the, you know, some of his other films I think are quite good too, and maybe even better than mm-hmm. Citizen Kane. But of course, it's always hard to say one film is better than another one, or this one is, you know, they all have different things going for them. You know, they're all
right.
quite different stories, and, you know, they're quite different looking movies. But he was such an innovative filmmaker. He came up with ideas before anybody else. He had the cutting edge ideas that were, you know, I mean, Paul Verhoeven was looking at Touch of Evil while he was making Showgirls because it still had such great ideas in it, you mm-hmm. know, that were giving him ideas for shots.
Mm-hmm.
So Orson was just so far ahead of his time technically, you know.
The kid that plays in Law and Order Special Crimes, David something on a Freo or whatever, he does a short called 5 Minutes with Mr. Wells.
Uh-huh.
And he is amazing in it. And it's all about he's trying to get ready to do a movie. And he's Wells. And, of course, he's got cold feet. He can't remember his lines. You know, it's very, it's a little bit noir in its own right, you know, that they're telling this story, how he's shacking up with this girl, and it turns out she's really a spy for the studio, and it, you know, if he doesn't pull himself together, they're not going to back him because he was notorious for walking out on projects.
Well, he never really walked out. I mean, he had a lot going on, and you know, he had a lot of projects always juggling, and it might have appeared that he disappeared at one time or another, but he was actually just, you know, thinking that he would go do something for a couple of weeks and then come back and do, you know, something else. And so in his mind it made quite, you know, it made logical sense, but it didn't always make sense for the studio.
No, because they're paying. It's Vincent D'Onofrio, 5 Minutes with Mr. Well, and mm-hmm. I love it. I think he's great, yeah. You know.
I mean, one of the big things was that he ran off, you know, because of, you know, Hollywood shunning him, or like after he did some of his films in the, I think, 48, he did Lady from Shanghai, and then I think maybe after that he went over to Europe and did a few films, and then he came back in, you know, 56, 57 to sort of reestablish himself, and then he did Touch of Evil after that, and then he had a problem with it. But actually he ran off the first time for the the tax evasion. I mean,
right.
he couldn't pay his taxes, and so the IRS was coming after him, so that's when he went to Europe the first time around.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, good old Europe.
He made some sort of deal when he came back in order to pay it off. But, yeah, so it usually comes down to money and quite humbling things, you know, other than these lofty artistic decisions.
Mm-hmm. So he's your best. You shot your film in 16 millimeter.
Yeah, I mean, Fellini I love. So many directors, and John Huston was great, and you know, there's so many that
you've worked with. So David good. Lynch.
David Lynch, yes, I worked with David Lynch on Lost Highway, which was another film noir. Yeah,
he's. I like him. I don't understand 90% of it, but I like him. You know, that's okay with me. The rabbit stuff. I kind of understand his rabbit skits that he does with the people with the rabbit heads on.
Right.
I kind of understand it. it's people will laugh at anything. You know, she's just ironing and people are laughing. And the guy says, come in, and people are laughing. So I kind of understand it. But how is he to work with? Is he a taskmaster?
Oh, he's a sweetheart. No, he's not really a taskmaster. He gives himself time to do what he needs to do. He's just a real hands-on guy. He's concerned with all the details that go in front of his lens. And he's concerned with the people's makeup and the costume colors and just all the details. He was really amazing, that he was so detail-oriented. But then it kind of makes sense, because if you look at his films, they are very specific and very detailed. They don't look haphazard at all. They look very planned out and very precise, you know.
You've been on you've worked a lot. You're a working actor. That, you know,
I am.
You are.
I do have a new movie that's out on some sort of pay-per-view cable called Dug Up, and it's a zombie comedy that I think it's going to be pretty good. I haven't seen it yet, but I hear it's pretty funny.
Yeah, there's what I call a working actor is someone who's always on to the next project, you know? We were talking before we went on air that someone in my family has just out of the blue decided they're going to get into acting, and I said, do you know how hard this is? You went to film school.
Yes.
I went to a little place
called Sherwood Oaks Experimental College.
Wow.
And it was taught by professionals in the business. Stanley Myron Handelman was my comedy coach, and then Robert Easton was a dialect teacher, and he was like the king of the dialect teachers. And different other teachers directing and whatnot who were in the business. And they were doing it. And so they would donate their time to this college, this film school. And it was mostly in night classes, but still it was incredible teachers that were teaching there because, they were all real professionals in the business.
Mm-hmm.
And so that gave it quite a different feel and a different edge, you know.
Mm-hmm. So you didn't start out wanting to be an actor. You started out wanting to be a magician.
Well, I started out as a magician because, when you're a kid and you want to perform, there's not a lot of options. You can't really do stand-up when you're a little kid, and you can't really, you can play a musical instrument, which is what most kids do, but I wasn't musically inclined. I mean, even though my mother gave me every musical lesson under the sun, I just didn't get it. It didn't stick.
Yeah.
And I could play the piano a little bit, but I wasn't really that crazy about it. So I started, I got a magic kit for Christmas or something, a bunch of little tricks, and I got really into it, and I started getting good at it. And so I started doing birthday parties and shows at, different events, and then I would do these big magic conventions. I would perform for all the other magicians at these magic conventions. And, little by little, I got pretty good. And when I first came out to Hollywood, I worked at the Magic Castle. And, I had a pretty good comedy magic act. I had several different comedic magic acts. I did the world's oldest magician, where I put on an old man mask and pretended to be super old, and none of the tricks really worked. And then I did an impression of Doug Henning at one time, who was a real popular magician in those days. I did an impression of Harry Blackstone Jr. So I was doing sort of these comedic impressions of magicians. And so that kind of led me towards comedy. Mm-hmm. And once I got out to L.A., I started going up on audition night at the local improv and the Comedy Store, and building my little, stand-up comedy routine. And, so it sort of gave me the audience time in front of an audience up until I started doing that, so which gave me a little bit of an edge, I think,
Yeah, when I lived in Metuchen, God dropped me in the middle of Metuchen, New Jersey, in my senior year of high school, and we had a young boy down the street from us named Seth Kotkin. Do you know that name?
No.
It's David Copperfield.
Oh, really?
Yeah. And you
well,
could
I do
not
know
go.
David Copperfield. He was a fan of my stand up act.
Yeah. You know, you kind of traipsed past quietly because it was, want to see a magic act? Want to see a new trick I learned?
Oh, really? Yeah.
You didn't see him a lot because his mother would take him into New York and into the magic shop there. And he was always. But that kid, he lived and breathed magic,
yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
Adorable little boy, you know? I guess he's like maybe 8 years younger or maybe 4 years younger. I don't know. He always looked like a Neverbug to me. But he was such a sweet boy. But it's like, you know, you'd go walking past his house to go to the bus and you'd be like, please don't let Seth be home. Please don't let Seth be home. And what made it worse is, his parents owned a haberdashery in town where everybody went to get – all the men went to get their clothes and stuff, you know.
Uh-huh.
But he – it was great. And when I first saw him and they said, oh, that new magician, you know, David Copperfield is on. And I'm going back 30 years ago and I'm like, I know that kid. He had a nose job. He had a nose job or something. I know that kid. But my new granddaughter, my one son married, and now I have a granddaughter through marriage, and she's very she got her first magic kit this past year, and so I'm getting ready to take her to see Rick Sapphire and his magic shop in Cherry Hill, New Jersey, because she's very into it. She goes nowhere without it. Let me put it that way.
Good,
so she's
good.
Yeah, she's a pretty kid. So I think what basically will happen is she's going to end up being, you know, in, you know, tights and stuff and doing her thing. They'll be too busy looking at her legs to know whether she's doing any magic or not. But getting back to David Lynch, you worked for him. You've worked with Robert Loggia. We just lost him.
We had a scene together in the David Lynch film, yeah.
Yeah, he
just passed on. I think
yes, he did.
Year, yeah.
Of Alzheimer's. Yeah.
Oh, was it?
Yeah. And you know, I wish they'd find something a cure for that because you know we're fighting a battle here. You know, but what an actor that man was. Was he like to work with?
Oh, he was wonderful. He's you know, just an old pro and. He's just trying to find the right way to do it, and you know, just he really liked me too, and so you know, we got along great, and just you know, had a lot of fun doing it. You know.
Okay.
And he was yelling at the top of his lungs, was sitting on top of me with a gun, beating me up with a pistol, and so you know, he had to be really careful not to actually hit me with it. But he was great.
Yeah, I mean, after a while, you get tired and say, you know. When is this over, you know? And he wasn't young. How old was he?
I don't know. He's probably in his late 60s at that time.
Yeah. You
that
get tired.
That was the late 90s, so.
Yeah, you get tired, and you're like, please, just make sure that gun doesn't just come down and wallop me in the nose and break my nose. You know, please.
Yeah.
I think he needs a break. I know I do.
Well, he was yelling all day in that scene. He did say he was exhausted after it was all over because that does take a lot of energy to yell, you know, at the top of your lungs during the whole scene all day. You know.
Yeah. Your movie is a bit of a would you call it a little bit of a comedy?
Oh, yeah, absolutely. Absolutely.
Yeah.
I mean, it's, you know, it's got a ton of comedic actors in it, and it's very funny. It's mostly a comedy. It does get a little serious with the horror aspect of it, with the vampires from time to time. But I think it's a good mix, you know. I mean, that's what makes it a fun mix, you know.
Yeah. You've got Julie Brown in it, Rick Overton, Joe Alasky. Your writers hang on with Steve Bishart. You wrote it. You're the producer and director of it, right?
We co-produced it, and I directed it, and he shot it. And so we kind of did it together. And then, you know, I pretty much took the film and did the final cutting and post-production on it. So,
how hard is it to keep your perspective when you're wearing so many hats? Because you even had a part in it. So,
well,
I mean,
it's not hard. I mean, when you grow up doing, I did films in high school. I did a feature film in high school called Joe Dynamite, where I showed it three nights to my classmates, and I made a profit. I mean, it cost me like $300 to make the whole thing, and you know, I made a deal with the theater. I mean, with the school theater, and promoted it and turned a profit. And thought, oh, this is easy. I just, you know, go out and make a movie and show it and make money. But it doesn't really work that way in Hollywood, you know.
No.
But the thing of it is like, you know, like anything, if you learn all the different aspects to it, you know, it's actually much easier to make a movie when you know all of the different aspects and how to do everything. You don't have to waste time. You don't have to consult all these other people in order to get something done. You know exactly what you need to do, and so it just makes it a lot of easier. I think most filmmakers, they know every job on the set.
Mm-hmm.
You know, when you're going to film school, that's what you do. You work as a sound man for a while on somebody's film, and you work as a cameraman on somebody else's movie, and you work all the different positions on the set so that you understand how they all work and what they all do.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so
But
being self-taught, you really go from the ground up because you're buying the film, you're working the camera, you're finding the locations, you're directing the actors, you're bringing it all together, and so that's how you learn. That's how you really learn.
I'm trying to remember what it was that Orson Welles was talking about doing. He did an interview, and he was filming, but he really didn't know anything about camera work at that point. And he was laughing because he realized if you shoot from one angle, it looks like people are walking away from you. But to get them to look like they're walking the other way, you have to shoot from another angle or something.
Mm-hmm.
And
right.
he says, I finally realized I had to learn something about the camera.
He says, you know,
because pretty much he did everything by the seat of his pants in the early days. And that could be a waste of time and resources, but you did have the schooling behind you.
Well, and was he had one before of the best cameramen in the business when he did Citizen Kane. You know, I was working. That was one of our, you know, our tough jobs was to get the camera and the photography just right. And for the most part, we did. We had some arguments in that area. As to the angles and how it should look in certain, you know, ways, and you know, trying to work all that out was a little difficult in the beginning. But finally, we came to an agreement, and the film has a definite, specific look to it, and mm-hmm. so that's what I really wanted, and I think we got that.
Yeah.
So, you know.
It looks like a black and white, you know.
Well,
it looks...
yeah, but there's more to it than that.
Yeah.
I mean, it looks, it's got a specific look and then some. And so, you know, there was a lot of little things that went into the photography that are not, you know, so evident when you just look at it. But it's a very cool little sophisticated film. And,
yeah.
And I'm hoping that it works for today's audience, being that it's, you know, 30 years old, it was a parody of a 1940s movie. So in that aspect, I think it'll still work because it still holds up with the jokes and the gags and everything. And we didn't play it campy like we're in a movie,
right,
making a movie or anything like that. We played it for real and gave it a real solid performance base with the actors. And I think that it works beautifully. You know?
I'm trying to compare when you made the movie and what was out there that people were watching that might have influenced you, because you know, you had like Chucky, the maniac doll, and you had back in my time, Dracula was not a nice guy. He didn't sparkle. Now vampires sparkle.
Right.
Mark Redfield says my vampires don't sparkle, you know, in his book series. But you did this. You started this project back in the 80s. And what was going on in film that you compared it to a little bit?
There weren't really that many. I think Steve Martin did a parody of a detective film called The Man in Plaid or something like that.
Right.
Or, he did one, and maybe there was a couple others, but it wasn't so much that we were influenced by anything that was that. We were looking at the older films. I was looking at, you know, Wells films like Lady from Shanghai.
Right.
And I was looking at, you know, some of the Maltese Falcon. And I, you know, looked at a lot of the early film noir, both European and American, just to sort of get the look and the feel and the tone. And that's really where the influence came from, you know. We wanted to do a parody of that with women vampires.
Yeah, that's the thing. I'm thinking the Night Stalker.
A little bit of a Fellini influence, too, because he always had these really gorgeous-looking creatures running through his movies.
Yeah.
And wanted a little bit of that as well. So maybe that was Fellini.
Yeah, like the Night Stalker was back in the 70s.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah, and they were still rerunning into the 80s. You know, my kids loved them, you know, and that. But you've got this great detective story, and you pulled out vampires for it. And I was, you know, what would make you go for that rather than a serial killer, a normal person serial killer, or a Charles Starkweather type of person?
I mean, the sexiness of it, for one thing. I mean,
yeah.
We wanted a certain sensuality, and the story worked better with, you know, the two women vampires. And they're lesbians. They're a couple. And, you know, the detective comes into the mix and kind of messes things up. And so it's about the two women trying to hang on to their relationship, you know, with this detective now in the mix and tracking him down. And so it has a really cool little interesting story along with it, you know.
So I want everybody to understand, it's not silly. It's not ridiculous.
No, but it is fantasy.
Right.
It's comic book fantasy. So it doesn't go silly or campy, but it does go fantastic from time to time, you know.
Talk about some of the people that are in it, because I'll tell you, the vampires, the lesbian vampires are very hot ladies.
Yeah, they're very hot. They're, Catherine Simmons was the lead vampire, and then Victoria Hughey was the younger one, and both beautiful, beautiful women. And I went to high school with Victoria. She ended up marrying one of my good friends and lived in New York. And then she came out to do the movie when we shot it. And so that was a lot of fun having her in there. And then Joe Alasky, who was a very fine voice actor who did a lot of cartoons for Warner Brothers. And he plays the fat man, which is sort of like the Sidney Greenstreet character,
right,
in the movie. And we had Mark Goldstein, who was a very funny stand-up comedian friend of mine at the time, and was pretty well-known in Hollywood, and he plays the sleazy Hollywood producer who's trying to get him to be in his movie, and so they end up biting him. And I play like a sitcom writer who's kind of a drunk, and I've got a Japanese girlfriend, and they come over to take her out, and then all hell breaks loose, and we end up having a big fight, and they kill me at the beginning of the movie. And so that's a lot of fun. And then who else? Robert Schimmel, who is a well-known stand-up comedian. He's since passed away, but he's also in it. And who else? We've got Julie Brown. Julie Brown, who plays the nurse and the friends of the vampire women at the end, and they come to visit her, and then, of course, she becomes a victim of their inexhaustible thirst, and she's very funny in it. So,
yeah, girls got to eat. You know, that's just the way it is. You know, no matter who you like, you know, you got to eat.
Absolutely. So, yeah, there's a great cast, and they're all really, really fun comedic actors, and everybody does a great job in it, you know. It holds up beautifully. I can't wait till the full house, you know, sees it from top to bottom. I just know they're going to react great to it. I know they're going to just love it, you know.
Zachary D. Schweitzer and Michael Meals are in the chat, and they're yelling out hello to you. You know, that it, welcoming you back to the show. I want to make sure I let everybody know that. Your idea, what makes you sit down and laugh? I'm okay, so what's your favorite TV show?
I like Breaking Bad. I like Walking Dead a little bit, but I'm not that keen on TV shows that much anymore. I used to when I was younger, but I just have a hard time following them now. I'm so busy doing what I'm doing. I miss episodes, and I can't really keep up with them that much. So when I usually watch TV, I'll usually watch a movie. Mm-hmm. And I have a large collection of movies, DVDs, that I watch from time to time. And of course, I got the cable and the Netflix and all of that. But every once in a while, I'll find something that's kind of fun that I've never seen before. But because I've been doing this so long and watching movies so long, I've seen all the films. I've basically seen everything. I'm really jaded when it comes to movies.
I was just going to say.
Seen everything.
Are you?
And then some, you know.
Are you hard to please because of that?
I think so.
You sit there and look at it.
I'm a tough audience. When I go to the movie, you know, it. 9 times out of 10, it's not really satisfying, you know.
Right. I sit there and I look at something and I'll put up with it so long and then I'll say, okay, what the, you know, what is this? Come on. You know, even if this person were brain dead, they would figure it out by now. Something's going on, you know. I don't like it when it's predictable.
Yeah, and you know, it's hard to
come up with a new idea.
This difficulty too. It's hard to have a line of tension in a movie. It's hard for some reason they used to know how to do that in older movies really well, especially the 60s and the 70s. To where you Hitchcock and then a lot of the other directors, they could have a line of tension where you're on the edge of your seat and you're dying to know what's going to happen at the end. And that is the key to a movie. You want to know what's going to happen at the end, you know? You're waiting to find out what the big ending is. And now so many movies just like build up to the end and then it just stops and cuts to the credits. And they don't give you a satisfying twist at the end. They just cut to black and then go, okay, it's up to your imagination to figure out what happened. You know, I think it's a bit of a cop-out and a bit of a... bit of a jip, you know.
There was a movie that was really hyped up, and it was a guy named Tim Burton, and it was Alice, and you know, I was good with it. I was on board all the way until the end, and I felt like. Somebody finally said, you realize this movie is over 2 hours long and we don't have an ending yet.
Oh, wow.
You know what I mean? The ending was like, wham, bam, thank you, ma'am. Here's the $5 on the cabinet. You know, suddenly she's on a ship out in the Orient. She's somehow gotten the business back, you know. And it kind of was like they worked so hard on the beginning and the middle, they forgot they had to bring about a conclusion. Uh-huh. And it was, you know, and I kind of went, what? What the heck? What the the heck was that? You know, and yeah. I'm finding a lot more movies are like that. They yeah. put so much, especially with the big special effects stuff, you know? And then you get to the end of it, it's like, what the heck? Yeah, what was that? Come on, you know, you yeah. just, yeah, and I
they
think
I tend to lose sight of the line of tension of the story, you know.
Right.
And I mean, it's a, you know, it's a pretty formulaic structure writing a movie script. You know, there's three acts. And the middle act is the long act. It's as long as the first and third act. And so at the end of that second act, there's certain things that are supposed to happen. And then they're resolved in the third act. And everybody kind of goes by that, but it can get really hard when they veer away from that and go off on little tangents
yeah.
where that you lose the viewer's interest because you've gone off the road and you've gone to a little, you know, side story that keps going on and on and on. And then you mm-hmm. lose track of your main story.
Yeah, the what I think has happened with a lot of movies and stuff is that during movies, and it drives me nuts, and it's why I don't take Teddy anymore, because I can't get through a movie without him having to go to the men's room three times. We've become a society where we're sitting in our parlor. Pause the movie. I'm going to go to the bathroom. Pause the movie. I'm going to go get a drink. Pause the movie. And
yeah.
I think that damages the movie for the viewer.
Yeah. yeah
because
bit, yeah.
it you've lost that train of thought. You mm-hmm. were in the grips of
it. And it's the same thing as when they do a commercial break and the commercials go on so long that you forget where you were in the movie. When you come
right.
back, you're like, what the hell movie am I even watching? You know, I forget what I'm even watching sometimes the commercials go on so long.
Yeah,
and
yeah,
so
Teddy's.
It makes it really hard. I mean, cable, when it first was invented, that was called commercial-free television.
Yes,
that
was
it was. Idea. You know?
Yes, it was. HBO, commercial-free.
Since then, all these cable channels that show movies have incorporated commercials. Not all
Even,
of them. There's still
yeah.
a lot of them that don't, that you pay for, but a lot of ones that you know, are on there.
Well, just, Turner Classic Movies will show the movie
yeah,
in its
Turner,
entirety.
That's a good one, yeah.
AMC,
they don't show commercials.
AMC yeah. started breaking them up and putting
yep.
the commercials in them. And that's when they lost
and now
me.
Now they go on for 10 minutes long with commercial
yeah.
breaks, 10 minutes long. It's too much.
Yeah, and yeah, it's kind of like having Alzheimer's, you know. You get lost in the commercials, and then you're off making a sandwich or you're off getting a Coke because, of course, they've just put that into your head during the commercial. I've got to go to Subway, you know, and then you forget to watch the rest of the movie. That's why I like to watch movies in my house with the DVD, and then if somebody gets up and moves, I pelt them with popcorn. You know, sit down. The movie's going, you know. Or I take a piece of ice out of it and throw it at them. Hey, shut up. The movie's on, you know. Because back in the day, that's what would happen to you if you were getting up and down and disturbing everybody in the movie theater, you know.
Yep, that's right. Yeah.
Gone with
yeah.
the Wind had a break in the middle of it because
right.
it was so long.
Right.
You know, some movies had that. But I think that we've become a society that has attention deficit.
Yeah, a little bit. I don't know that I'm so sold on the idea that all these kids have ADD. I think it's probably something else going on there. I mean, I was a little bit ADD when I was a kid, but, you know, I sort of mellowed out after that, and I don't need any kind of drugs or need any kind of thing. I think
well,
it's just, you know,
I just mean the ability.
Growing pains. Kids get a little, you know, bored
antsy.
And a little bit,
yeah.
You know, antsy at different periods as they're growing up. You know, I don't know that it's necessarily a bad thing. You know?
Yeah, but I'm not talking about kids as much as, you know, adults who can't sit through the movie without,
yeah.
you know, holding a conversation or checking their text phone.
That's bad. Yeah, that
movies,
is bad.
Movies,
I don't understand that.
Yeah, either. Movies were meant to take you into another dimension in your
right.
head.
And that's why going to a theater and having the theatrical experience
yeah.
gives you the movie experience so much better. Not only do you get lost in the big screen, but you're not distracted by all the stuff at home with the phones and the other people. You know, you actually have a chance to get lost in the movie. You know?
Well, Chris and I went to see Mr. Holmes with Ian McKellen, and there were some kids in the back of us that just would not shut up. And finally, this big burly guy got up and said, you know, that's it. And he went and got management and said, shut them up. I paid for this movie.
Right.
They're ruining it for everybody. We can't even hear the movie over them, you know. I think when people go to theaters even, they have to be taught manners. Because you know what? I don't want to hear you eating your chicken wings. I don't want to hear your soda going ching ching every time you lift it. I don't want to hear somebody say, pass me the popcorn. You know, you're in a movie theater, for God's sake. Go do your hog pen eating when you get done with the movie. I paid money. And that movies are expensive to see now.
Yes, they are. Yes, they are. And you don't want that experience, you know, messed up with some kind of distraction from somebody who doesn't understand that they're supposed to be quiet and respectful.
Yeah, I don't know. And that's where I think the attention deficit, I think people have forgotten how to behave in
well,
movie theaters.
I think it has a lot to do with their learning. Nobody's teaching them anything to begin
right.
with. And then the second part of it is, they're all going from the cues that they get at home, watching the movie on the television at home. They think they're at home watching it when they're in the theater, you know?
Right.
And it's just, it's too bad that nobody's straightening them out and kind of giving them the cue as to what to do and how to do it. You know?
So you're having an opening, a debut for the movie?
World premiere. And,
world premiere.
The theatrical premiere of the movie on April 1st at the NUART Theater, 11272 Santa Monica Boulevard, which is right near the 405 and Santa Monica Boulevard. And so this theater is a real old Los Angeles, theater that, mm-hmm. you know, was one of the first ones to show the midnight movie. So, mm-hmm. yeah. And
it wouldn't be the same one that Ed Wood had his movie premiere in, would it? Plan 9?
No, I don't think so.
Wow, that's a movie opening. Comic. You're a very good stand-up comic. I have a clip when you leave. I'm going to play. It's 13 minutes long. And how was your St. Patrick's Day this year?
Kind of uneventful. I was going to go to a party, and I don't drink anymore. So
no, neither do I.
You know, I've been like 8 or 9 years without drinking, and I just...
good for you.
I was driving back from somewhere, and I saw these lines around the block at these bars, and I was like, it's going to be a lot of drunks out on the road. I think I'll pass on this year's festivities, you know.
Yeah.
So I didn't really even go out and do anything. But
yeah, I gave up drinking about 25, 30 years ago.
Yeah.
And I don't miss it, but...
No.
In your skit, you talk about being Irish and Scottish, and the family got together, and, you know, it ended up with everybody in a fisticuffs, you know. and I laughed because, you know, that kind of, it's St. Patrick's Day gets such a bad rap because a lot of people that go to the parades and stuff aren't Irish, you know. I'm not mm-hmm. saying that there aren't a fair amount of drinkers in the Irish. But when I was being raised, it was a holy day, you know? And we had lamb or maybe Irish ham, you know. But lamb was cheaper back then for us, and it was the main dish, you know. And you know, what we did do was the whole family took turns having what kind of is called a cayley, a gathering. And like my Aunt Rosie would have the whole family over one week, and then my Aunt Teresa would have the rest. And you know, they would be doing the jokes. And, you know, it was after World War II when the guys started drinking a lot. And then there would normally be some kind of altercation at the end of it, you know, that old joke, and the survivors of the party were, you know. So I don't those days. I don't miss those days. We had a dinner here Saturday, and I firmly put my foot down and said there is one toast to the sisters, I call them, because they're the ones who held us together when we got here, you know, by hooks, crook, steal, beg, borrow. The three sisters kept the whole family together, you know. And I says, one shot to them of Irish mist and one Irish coffee. This is not a drinking party. There are 12 bottles of Smittick in there. And that is it. That is it. And yeah, I was good with that. I was good with it. It was uneventful. It was very nice. We had a good time, and nobody got punched in the face.
Yeah, we never did get too violent either. My mother's side of the family was Irish, and they had they had three kids with her dad, but her father's saying that they had eight boys and three girls, and they're the ones that came over and, you know, started a farm down in the Texas Irish Ridge, which was a big community of Irish in Texas. Yeah. And so, no, I don't remember them having any. They were Catholic, but they weren't big drinkers. They drank a little bit, but they didn't get violent or anything. They were all really sweet people.
Yeah.
You know? I like Irish. I think Irish people are really nice and, they're usually very well mannered, and you know, usually pretty even keeled people.
Yeah, I've been hanging out with them my whole life. You know, and it's because of your stand up routine that I'm going to play. You're talking about the kids in the stores, you know, and
that one, yeah.
Oh my God, you know, I'm sitting there laughing. You know, I was. Teddy, my mother, and I, my mother was still alive. We went, for some unknown reason, God said in my ear, why don't you go to the Irish Festival in Wildwood, New Jersey? And I thought that sounded like a really great idea. And and we're walking along the road because everybody is drunk. And this guy is raking. And he said, he's got a kitty there, and he says, come here, I want to show you something. And just, he says, there's something you're never going to see again. So I'm looking around thinking I'm going to see like a parade float or something like that. And he's staring at us. And he says, three Irishmen who are still sober at the Wildwood Irish Festival, you know. And I says, well, I don't drink. And I says, you got to remember something, dude. Most of the people that are peeing on your lawn, they're not even Irish. They're just coming for the party,
yeah,
you know?
Exactly.
So don't label us all, you know? But you do a little bit in that stand-up which about the kids running through and hiding in the clothes racks.
Right, in the stores, yeah.
Well, I've got a good one for you. We were in a Sears, and my Matthew was maybe 6 years old, 7 years old. And for some unknown reason, he decided he was going to hide on me. And all of a sudden, the whole damn rack comes down, and all there is these little feet hanging out. He knocked he knocked himself out cold. This whole metal bar came right down on his head. And of course... And I still blame that for all the crap he pulls. But, you know, you know, Sears was, oh, my God, you know, he came around, you know, and I right. slapped him in the mouth for it. You know, are you awake now? Yeah, don't be doing that again. What's the matter with you? You're making a fool out of me in front of people. What's the matter? You know, because I'm an Irish mother and that's what you got to do, you know.
Right.
So your stand up cracked me up. How much of that is just shtick and how much does that drive you nuts with kids in the stores?
Well, I was taking it from my personal experience. I used to get lost all the time from my mother, you know, because I could get away with it with her, but not from my father. He would just say, you know, if I have to look for you, I'm leaving you. And, and so he didn't mess with that. But, there's a lot of little personal things that that I incorporate into that, absolutely.
You're a funny, funny guy, and when you're doing your stand-up, you become a little kid when you're talking about that. No, Dad, I'm following you. You are, when you watch you, you've become a child again, and you're. Yeah. I'm watching you, and I see a child.
Yeah,
you know,
yeah.
You're a good actor, and you do filter things well. When you're trying to get your point across, you do filter it well so that people know exactly what you're saying, you know?
Oh, okay, good. Thank you.
You know, I know I'm not making myself clear, but
I understand exactly.
Yeah, I looked at you and I thought, yep, that's Matthew the little bastard.
Well, I think the Irishness in me has probably given me a lot of my talent. Evidently my grandmother was kind of a poet and an actress in her early years, and mm-hmm. so maybe that's where I got some of it from.
Mm-hmm.
But kind of an outgoingness that, you know, gives you a little bit of an edge, you know,
mm-hmm.
when it comes
yeah.
to performing and not being afraid to get up in front of a group of people and do something. And,
The singing, you know, I was raised with my old man with the mouth harp, you know, and my mother, and they would roll up the rugs and put the rugs aside, and my grandfather played a squeeze box, my grandmother played the violin, and, you know, the family got together, and then there would be the joke-telling and the storytelling and then reminiscing and, you know, the whole nine yards. And then you would be shipped off into a bedroom, one of the bedrooms, and everybody would go to sleep there, you know, and be bundled up and taken home when it was time for everything to be over.
I
loved those memories.
Yeah.
It was when families were strong.
There was so much more culture then. And, mm-hmm. you know, I remember our family get-togethers. And, you know, the adults would, you know, have their drinks and get together and go around the table and laugh mm-hmm. and talk for hours and hours and hours.
Yep.
And they didn't kowtow to the kids too much. They didn't
No.
There would be one person that was kind of looking after the kids, but basically, the kids were kind of like shunned from those the big table, and they were kind of like, okay, you guys go play and, you know, behave yourself, but mm-hmm. don't bother the adults. And now everything is so centered around the kids, you know?
Yeah.
That the adults can't sort of have their own time and their own little, group to converse with, because they got to have a kid popping up and all that all the time, you know? And
yeah. I wonder what the kids are doing.
Because,
that's...
I think it was more beneficial to the adults to have their own time together and also for the kids to go play with each other, you know?
Yeah, my cousin Julie would look in and we would be like listening to them telling jokes and they would be roaring at the table, and mm-hmm. Julie would look in and say, what are you doing awake? You know, you got to be going to sleep, you know? And, you know, she'd never rat us out, you know, and that. But you're right. The adults have centered their worlds around the kids, and now the kiddies they don't do anything. They don't think for themselves. They don't, mm-hmm. I don't know. When I turned 17, it was time to get a license. My friend took me around, you know, showed me how to drive. I went and got my license. My parents didn't do anything. Do you know what I mean?
I see what you're saying. Yeah.
Now kids are...
They just let you handle that.
Yeah. Now you got a 15, 16-year-old kid that doesn't walk 1,000 feet across the street to a convenience store. You know, it's almost like they're not empowered anymore, kids, you know? I had the Mitchum.
Are parents now just overly protective and just worried about every little thing that they won't let them do things on their own as much, I think.
And you know why? Because we see it all on the news now 24/7.
But, you know, I don't buy that it's not safe anymore for kids. I really don't.
No.
I mean, in certain areas, yes. I mean, there's a lot of crime in certain areas in certain cities. But for the most part, I'm not seeing this totally dangerous environment that everybody thinks they're living in all the time. I just don't see it. I don't believe it. You know?
I know it's out there, and I'm not going to bore everybody with it. But the thing is, we're not teaching children to deal with it. We're just sheltering them from it.
Yeah.
And that's a difference. When we were young, your parents told you, don't you be taking no rides with any strangers because I'll feckin' kill you. You know? Don't you be doing this. Don't you be doing that. I was more afraid of my parents than I was... thinking, oh, I'm going to, you know, hey, this guy offered me a ride. I'll go with him in the car, you know? Oh, no. Right. Oh, no. My old man knows how to use a belt.
Yeah, exactly.
You know? And I'm not saying we have to make our children afraid of us, but we do have to get them prepared for the world. So your vampires, they're sexy. They're hungry. Are they sparkly?
Are they what?
Sparkly. Like the new vampires.
I don't know if they're sparkly or not.
They've got
very distinct personalities. They're there's the head, Serena is the head vampire, and she's been around the longest. She's lived for thousands and thousands of years, and there's one point where she kind of flashes back on all of her old lives, you know, since she first became a vampire, and she wants to die because she's just tired of living. She's tired of trying to keep a relationship together. It's just not working for her anymore, and so she really wants to kick it. But she goes to visit the moon goddess, who I guess is her sort of overseer, and so, you know, she shows her all of her lives and says, you know, you've had a fantastic run, and you know, sorry, but vampires have to live forever, you know. Mm-hmm. You're immortal. And so, you know, there's just no getting out of that contract.
Well, there is, so, but it's got to be painful.
Yeah.
It's got to be painful.
And so, she does end up, having a battle at the end, and I'm not going to tell you what happens.
Okay, but, now let me ask you, now that you got the bug and you finished it, mm-hmm. Are you looking and thinking maybe you'll go on to make a second one, continue the story?
No, because I'm not a big sequel person.
No?
All of my films have a unique story, and I think a sequel is just repeating the same story again, you know?
Yeah.
Every time I see a sequel to a movie, it's the same exact thing. It's just told a little differently, and it's just a little different tweaking of it, and... you know, maybe they'll up the stakes a little bit and have a few more special effects. But
yeah, I don't know how many.
I think if you do a good job on the one movie, that it should stand alone. And you only do a sequel for commercial reasons, to make more money off of the same idea. You know?
Yeah, I don't know how many more religious relics folklore Indiana Jones can fall over.
Yeah.
Somebody posted on Facebook about, you know, there's some people that are saying that, what's his name, is too old to be doing, Harrison Ford is too old to be doing, you know, the movie.
Oh, I see. Yeah.
And I personally don't see that. I mean, that's life. We age.
Sure.
There is a cure to aging, and also, again, it sucks. You know, I love my birthday. You know, I want my birthday to go until I'm 300 years old, you know.
Right.
You know, because there's only one way you don't have a birthday. So my entire, from May 1st to the end of May is my birthday month. I celebrate all month long. And people say, oh, my birthday. Oh, shut the hell up. You know, really, grow up, you know. If you want, you know, there's only one way out of a birthday. But I think as long as the story is good, I don't have a problem at all with him.
I think certain movies like an Indiana Jones are more of a do lend themselves to more of a sequel, like Star Wars, you know, lends itself to sequels because that's kind of an ongoing soap opera.
Right.
You know?
Well, that's what The Walking Dead is.
Another adventure and another adventure.
Yeah.
But I don't know. My movies, I kind of like see them as their own little world and their own little story and their own little one-time book, if you will.
Right.
And I don't really want to get into trying to repeat it in a different way.
Yeah, you used the word I was looking for.
It would just be too, you know, it kind of takes away from the original, you know.
Right.
If the second one's not good, it takes away from the original experience, I think. You know?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's like book series, you know.
Yeah.
You know, and everybody will ask me, you know, have you been watching The Walking Dead? I watched it the first season. I watched it the second season, and then I said, "This is a soap opera."
Yeah,
this is
kind of soap opera-y, you know. After a while, and I think this past season it really slowed down. It was like molasses trying to get through one of those. And
I have no idea. All I know is I would have killed Andrea and the wife the first episode.
Yeah,
I would have put the wife was shacking up with the cop's best friend.
Oh, that's right. Yeah,
and
yeah,
Andrea
yeah.
was the woman, and she's crying all the time.
Yeah.
I put a bullet through her head. She's collateral damage and killed the wife. She's nothing but a two-timing bitch.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, let's move on with the story, guys. You know, let's just move on. But that's me, and that's why I'm not good to watch
this stuff.
Yeah, they kind
of dragged that out a little bit. And,
I'm kind of hoping I hear the words final season, because the thing that upsets me the most with that, now I don't know how gory you're when they kill the vampires and all that stuff
it's not that gory. It's in keeping with kind of a 40s sensibility.
Okay.
You know, there's a little blood in it, but it's not that bad.
But you see, when you've got a zombie and you're saying the brain has to keep alive, it keeps going, and they stake it, and powder comes out. You've kind of just destroyed. What exactly was making this brain work? That it's, you know, it's like art powder coming out of there.
It bothers me a lot that if, like, when they get into these zombie battles and they get blood all over themselves, they just walk around with it on themselves like it's no big deal, man.
Yeah.
The first thing I would do would be washing that zombie blood off my clothes and my face. And
yeah, somebody got a wet towel.
I would get a wet towel and, you know, get it wet and then clean myself up. First thing, that would be the first thought that would go through my mind after I kill a zombie.
Anybody got a bottle of Jack Daniels? And then I'd pour it all over myself, you know? I mean, really, you know? I know. And I suppose the idea is, and we're a Marine family, so when my son was over in Iraq, he was on a special tour, and when they finally pulled them in 9 months later, they got his group and put them in this, like, corral. And they had this big drum burning. And they told them, take your clothes off, everything, your shoes, everything, and throw them in the drum.
Oh, that's burn it all?
They, wow. That's how bad they smelled.
Wow.
That's how, because you don't, when you're in battle, you don't wear cologne. You don't wear deodorant. You don't right. wear something that these people are going to smell and go, what is that?
Right.
You know,
exactly.
you know, yeah. So they smelt like dung heaps. And my son said, I can't believe they made us burn everything. We were standing in the crowd and they handed us a paper towel and then marched us into the showers. I says, Jesus, it sounds like Auschwitz, you know, God Almighty, you know, okay, boys, now you're going to go into the shower, you know? And he says, but I says, yeah, it's reeked, you know, they had to do something. There was no way you, Febreze was taking care of that problem, guys.
Wow.
You were out for 9 months, you know?
Wow.
And this was early in Iraq, you know? And I says, yeah. I says, you guys don't smell it anymore, you know? But they could smell you coming in, you know, 3,000 feet away. What the hell is that smell, you know? And you're right. These people, I guess their idea is that they don't smell each other anymore. Survival is the most important thing. But I can't get past the thing where they stake a walker's head and this powder comes out, but this walker has been able to, you know, function and still have that, I'm going to eat, you know, and I laugh about it.
I haven't seen that one.
Yeah, there's a lot of them. They stake it and they pull it out and this powder comes with them. And I'm going, all right, how the heck was that thing walking around? I'll even go with, you know, in the very first episode, the chick's got only like the chest cavity and she's dragging herself away and he blows her brains out. And that was wet, you know. So there was something going on in the brain that was wet, you know. But come on, come on, you know, let's get real here. But you see that Norman Redis was at a fan thing, like one of those conventions, and mm-hmm. one of the fans tried to bite him.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Wow.
She tried to bite him, and she says, "I'm sorry, I got so wrapped. You need a lobotomy, chick. You know? Yeah. So, you're not a fan of redoing things. So, what inspires you? What makes you go? You know what? I think that's going to be my next project."
That's a really hard one because I've always got about, I mean, I've written so many movies over the years, not only for me to direct, but for other directors as well. And it's hard because there's a lot of factors going into it. Like, I still haven't decided what my next movie after Dark Seduction is going to be because am I going to go for a bigger budget? Which, you know, obviously, yes, I should go for a little bit bigger budget. But how much bigger? Am I going to go for $3 or $4 million, or am I going to go for a couple hundred thousand? I mean, you have to, and that determines what kind of a movie you're going to make, and you know, how you can make it, and the planning of it, and all of that. And so, you know, maybe a little less money is a little easier to get to do a movie. That's you know, what is it going to be? I don't know yet. I've got about 4 or 5 scripts that I've got finished that are well developed, and you know, I was planning to do all 3 of these scripts and maybe in a Texas location, and so I'm still looking into that. That's a possibility, and I don't know. Maybe I'll do something totally different that I haven't even thought of yet, but. I'm not rushing it. I'm not going to decide until I feel like I've got to do all the business with Dark Seduction and get that out and get that going. And once I feel comfortable that it's up and running and out there, then I can start looking into the next one. You know.
How much of yourself do you parallel in these? I mean, you did that one midlife
more than others because
yeah.
that was my... Because I'm playing a lead, and I wrote it and directed it, and it's, you know, it's a character that, you know, I just created based on, I guess, some of my life experiences and some experiences from other people.
Yeah.
And, you know, just kind of mixed it up in a mixed bag. And, it didn't really have a lot to do with me personally.
No, but it did reflect society.
That I had thought about that are happening in society now.
Yeah.
And so I wanted to express them with that type of a character.
Yeah, because it did reflect society at what we were just talking about with kids and parents.
Yeah.
You know, the parents are so busy trying to be the kids' friends and busy going out and, you know, the three-bedroom house isn't enough. They've got to have a six-bedroom house with, you know, a game room. And the kids are in every conceivable club there is. The soccer, the baseball, the little league, the football, the cheerleading, the dance, the gymnastics. Mm-hmm. And life is just so busy for some people that I saw a lot of that in that movie.
Yeah. Yeah.
Trying to just hold it together.
Well, I was that way. My mother worked all the time, and so she put us in classes. We had music lessons. We had acrobatic lessons. We had these, you know, whatever lessons, whatever we could think of, she would, like, go along with it. And because it was something to do after school that, you know, would give us, you know, something to, you know.
Yeah, you know,
so we had a lot of lessons, which I think is an overall thing. I think it's probably pretty good. Extracurricular activity after school, I think it's a good thing. You know?
Yeah. Back in my day, a lot of this went on in the school. You know, in gym, you were taught dancing and the square dancing and all this stuff. And I see a lot of that acting lacking in education, but. For me, I specifically put Christine in gymnastics and ballet because she kept falling every time she took a step. She made a truck driver look graceful. And I said, I looked at Teddy and I said, Jesus Christ, she walks like a truck driver. And we decided to put her into ballet and gymnastics. And I got to tell you, I've never been sorry about that. Never. Yeah. Because
well, it's sad, too, because, you know, so many parents are not assertive like that with their kids. They just kind of let their kids grow up on their own and they don't really. They don't see the fault. I mean, you know, my feet started turning a certain way when I was a kid. And I had to wear like a shoe thing with a bar in the middle of it.
So did my Andrew.
I had to sleep with this thing on to make sure that my feet were going to turn the right way. I think when I was like 5 or 6 years old. And just my mother was so cutting edge. I mean, she was on top of that stuff like you wouldn't believe. You know?
Yeah. Yeah, we did that with Andrew.
Could do to help us. You know, be better and look better. And boy, she was doing it. And I really thank her for that because there's not a lot of parents, even though she worked and she wasn't around a lot of times, she overcompensated with all of the other stuff, you know.
Yeah, my Andrew was 9 pounds, 10 ounces. And I was a tiny person. And so when he was born, his legs were bent. Because they were like he was like sitting in an Indian position, you know, and so right away we had to put the bars on him, and that was a fight in our house because of course he would cry because he was restricted, and Teddy'd say it's hurting him, and he'd take them off, and I'd put them back on, and Teddy'd take them off and put them back on, you know. But that's being a parent, you know.
Yeah,
you fight with each other and say, look, you want the kid to be able to walk or not, you know. And by the time he was 2 years old, they were straight, you know. But what a battle getting there, you know. You have an anti-bully on YouTube, and I want to play it for everybody, and then I want you to comment on it because I was very impressed with this. Okay,
oh, okay.
So let's just play it, and I'm going to mute the mics. Okay.
All right.
Talking about bullies, I was pretty small growing up in the state of Texas, and I had many a run-in with bullies. I tried to joke my way out of the situation most of the time, but unfortunately, bullies don't have a sense of humor. So I took karate and learned how to defend myself. That was a long time ago. I find it hard to believe that we still have this bullying problem in schools. The fact of the matter is most bullies are insecure and take their anger issues out on others. Well, that's too bad, because believe me, no one deserves to be bullied and no one likes a bully. Whatever problems you have at home, don't take it out on others at school. By disrespecting others, you're disrespecting yourself.
Life is hard enough without causing trouble. And remember, that bully reputation never goes away. So instead of picking on someone, try it.
Okay. That was Greg Travis. Tell us about that bully, because I love it.
I was asked to do like a public service announcement by this little company, and so I put that together, basically just wrote it in one day with my assistant helping me shoot it. And, you know, I grew up in Texas with a pretty rough, in junior high especially, with a pretty rough crowd, and just country kids and kind of urban, not urban, but they were all like kind of rough kids. And mm-hmm. So there was a lot of bullying going on, a lot of fighting going on. And so I definitely had my share of that when I was junior high, especially. And mm-hmm. When I moved into high school, I did get into the martial arts, and I started, you know, learning karate and was able to keep care of myself. And just by doing that, it kind of puts a different confidence in a kid. And I think people pick up on that. You know, that this is not going to be a pushover. Because
right.
I was little. I was always littler. Is that a word? Littler? I was always
smaller.
Smaller kid. I didn't mm-hmm. grow until I almost got out of high school.
Right.
And, you know, I grew about 5 inches out of high school. So I was always kind of little. Mm. So,
Yeah,
I just thought I would try to help out and do a little public service announcement.
It's something you said in there reminded me of the old movie Stand By Me, mm-hmm. where the younger boys have the older brothers, except for the one whose brother is dead, but they overhear about the dead body, and the one says, "You little shite," you know, and he starts slapping him around, and Phoenix Rivers' brother is, you know, he lets the bullies beat up his little brother because they're all beat up at home, you know, mm-hmm. they're products of what has raised them, you know, and I don't understand, and I'm exactly where you are. I don't understand why it's still going on. To the extent, it seems like it's gotten worse.
Yeah, it's just ignorance in the culture, you know. And you've got all these different elements of culture now that, you know, have that in their makeup. And they, you know, they bully each other at home, and so then they bring that to school. And, you know, what if something happens to girls around 6th and 7th grade, I remember having these two girls that really loved me in 3rd grade, and they turned on me in 7th grade when we got up to junior high, and just, it was like I was the worst person in the world because they had loved me both, and we'd been like little boy, a little threesome, you know?
Yeah.
Not, you know, just a little innocent
yeah.
threesome. In 3rd grade, but when I got into 7th grade, they just became terribly aggressive against me, and I never mm-hmm. could figure out what went wrong.
Yeah,
I never could figure out what I did. It was just a change of hormones or a change of something, and man, they turned on me like you wouldn't believe. They would give me hell all the time.
You see this stuff where they're videotaping each other, beating each other up. They're egging each other into beating peach. It's terrible. And you look and say, what the heck happened? My granddaughter, when she was in preschool, I got a call. She was going to this Jewish synagogue down the way, and I had to go pick her up. And they mm-hmm. said, well, it's not her fault, but we have a zero tolerance deal going on here. Okay, you're a synagogue. I got it. And what it was is every little toy she picked up, this boy would take it out of her hand and walk away from it. Mm-hmm. And the teacher was watching this go down until the fourth toy got pulled out of her hand. And then the teacher said, even the rabbi upstairs heard the punch. She decked the kid.
Oh, she decked him. And, that's different, though. That's bullying, you know.
Yeah, and I laughed, and I says, well, he won't be taking her toys no more. But right. The kind of bullying we see now, I find, what the heck is going on with everybody? I thought the hippies were going to solve all this crap.
No, they didn't solve anything.
Yeah, I'm going to ask you to give all your information because I have a 13-minute clean set. I love that. It's a clean set. It's a stand-up of yours, and I want people to hear you doing your stand-up because I related to everything in it and laughed really. I just giggled right through it.
Oh, good.
But I want you to tell everybody where the movie's coming out, how they can get information about it, and where they can contact you.
Okay, well, it'll probably be coming out in a couple of months on VOD, Video On Demand, and DVD later in the summer. But the big premiere for the first theatrical showing is at the NUART Theater in Santa Monica, on Santa Monica Boulevard, and that's April 1st at midnight. We're going to do the screening at midnight, and there'll be a red carpet before that, and anybody living in Los Angeles area, please come out and support Dark Seduction's premiere. It's 11 for adults and 9 for students, and I would love to see you, and I'm sure you'll enjoy the movie. And so it'll be coming out on VOD and DVD later on.
Where can they, your site is?
I have a website, my production company called gtfilmproductions.com.
Yeah, and that would be for Greg Travis, GT.
Yes.
Filmproductions.com and / Dark Seductions. And he has everything on there, stills, all kinds of clips, information on there telling you all about it. He's the director. He's also producer, and he also does a part in it. And your Facebook, is Greg Travis, right?
Yeah, I have a Greg Travis Facebook.
How about Twitter?
There's also a Dark Seduction Facebook for the movie
right.
as well. Yes.
Twitter?
Twitter, I'm Greg the Actor on Twitter.
Okay.
Greg the Actor.
Yeah, because there is more than one of you, if I found that out.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, there's a lot more than one of you. It must have been a very popular name.
I guess so.
Yeah, I can't thank you enough for coming on. I hope it's a great success. I'm going to play that comic bit for you. So,
okay.
All you have to do is hang up because I don't want to hang you up any more than I have already. Okay?
All right. Well, thank you so much, Gail. I really appreciate it.
I really appreciate you coming on, and good luck with it.
Okay. Thanks, sweetie. Goodbye.
God bless. He's a great guy. He is just a grand guy. I'm going to play Weather Report, Barbary Coast, and then a 13-minute bit of his that I think you guys are really going to enjoy. And anybody who's a parent knows, has been in this position, I think you guys are really going to enjoy it. It's clean. You don't have to, get all worried about what you're hearing. But I want you to hear him do, Greg do stand-up comedy. This is from December that he's doing it. So right after after Weather Report, Barbary Coast, and my promo, you'll be listening to Greg Travis on stage live doing his stand-up. And I hope you're enjoying the show. I'm over the moon. My guest tonight is Bob Greenberg. This is a free record.
Yes.
Hey, ladies and gentlemen, himself, as we say in the Irish, Eddie Benitez, welcome to the lair.
Thank you.
Yeah. How are you doing?
Hello.
Hello, Sarah Karloff?
Yes, hi. How are you, Mo?
I'm fine. Welcome to the lair.
Terry Soto, Captain Celluloid from the movie TV conventions that he holds in New York. Welcome to my lair.
Hello, Mo. Thank you for having me back.
And our guest, Arch Hall Jr., aviator, musician, author, and everything else. I think you walk on water. Welcome to my lair.
Well, thank you, Mo. Thank you. Good to be on with you tonight.
Michael Patrick Boatman, welcome to Mo Banshee's Lair.
Thank you, guys. Thank you for having me. I'm glad to be here.
This is Mo inviting you to listen to my show, Mo Banshee's Lair. We feature a variety of topics, A to Z, and guests, all kinds of guests. Mo Banshee's Lair, Tuesday evenings at 9 p.m. Eastern on DreamStreamRadio.com. And I'll see you, my pretties.
Well, go ahead and bring him up then. I know you're going to dig him next week. Come to see you, folks. Dear friend of mine, tons of stuff. Tons of movies. You may have seen on The Tonight Show. He's also been on HBO. He did The Improv. He's here for it tonight. Rock the house. Show some love. Big Sur City Comedy Club. Welcome for Mr. Greg Trevin. We did the traditional Irish Scottish Christmas at my place. That's where we drink whiskey and play the bagpipes until a fight breaks out. And it was a fun time to be had by all. It's like UFC for the whole family, it is. Did anyone see the UFC Conor McGregor fight?
Yeah.
Conor McGregor?
Yeah.
It's over. That was about it. Fat lasted 13 seconds. That's it.
It's over.
$35 pay-per-view. Done. That fight. I've seen longer fights at Black Friday between two big fat women over a toy. That fight was ridiculous. Women take their shopping serious. They will fight over an item, I noticed, you know. Because women look at shopping as a sport. Am I right, ladies?
Yes.
Yeah. And the mall is their arena. Christmas is like the Super Bowl. First thing they're going to make their way past those perfume women at the front counter. No, don't spray that cocoa crap on me. Run over to the sales rack. Knock the other mother out of the way. Grab the dress and get back to the counter. 50% off. Score! It's a sport. Guys are not very good at this sport because we usually go into a store to get, you know, something we need. Need a pair of socks? There's $10. Got a pair of socks. Nobody got hurt. Of course, you get in trouble when you bring them home and show your old lady. Look, honey, bought a pair of socks.
You did what? Why didn't you call and consolidate before you bought those socks? Time to make sock sale this weekend. The mall across the street's big sock sale, sock sale, sock sale!
Didn't know I needed them until I got to work without them. It's getting blistered, baby. Hurt bad. Get in trouble buying stuff.
Because women, you know, everything's got to be on discount, on 30% off, 50% off, on sale, going out of business sale. It's like an insult to buy full price. Am I right, ladies? For the professional pro sports shop. Man, I'll tell you, and women will take things back. I mean, I'm barely getting the package over. You can take it back if you don't want it. Let me look at it first. Well, you can always take it back. Exchange things, return things. I'd rather eat paint than go back to the store and stand in that return line. I'd just soon pause in the street and take the loss. I'm not going to take it back. They will spend all weekend taking things back. They take things back for each other. Oh, I'm going to that store. Do you want me to take it back for you? Taking things back. They don't even need a receipt. It could be the wrong store. They'll still get a cash refund. They know how to return things. We don't understand that. Stores are weird. I have bad memories of stores. When I was a little kid, I used to get lost all the time in stores. I could get lost in a 7-Eleven, I swear to God, I really can. Not for my dad, though. Just for my mother, because my dad wouldn't play that game. He'd always say something like, if I have to look for you, I'm leaving him. Oh, God. You're not leaving me in no Sears. Right behind you, big guy. But with mom, you just stand in the coat rack and watch her look for you. She's got the cops out now. 5 hours later, you come walking up. Oh, hello. She goes that quiet, intense whisper. Where were you? I was looking for you for about 5 hours. Wait till mommy gets you in the parking lot. Then she turns into Bruce Lee in the parking lot. Stay with mommy. Moms are intense. Sometimes. Yeah. Any parents in the audience? Why do parents wait till like Sunday afternoon at Walmart to beat their children? What is that? It's like a war zone in that place every Sunday. Naked children running up and down the aisle. Indiana dad whips his belt off. Put that toy back. It's unbelievable. I don't think you ought to hit kids unless they're your own. No, I feel sorry for little kids, really. Because when you think about it, little kids are just like little bums. They're just like little homeless people. They don't have any money. They gotta beg for everything they get. You see them begging in the stores all the time. Oh, please, mommy. I need this toy. I haven't played in weeks. You can't afford that. God bless you anyway, mommy. The dads will give up money to kids easier than moms will, because dads snap after a certain amount of begging. All right, here's a 20. Leave me alone. I'll be in the automotive section. Stay in the toy section. But moms are tough. They hang on to their cash. Kid could be strapped to mom's leg, digging his nails in, screaming bloody murder. Oh, my God! Everybody else in the store's ears are bleeding. Shut that kid up! Mom's just standing there oblivious to it all, looking at the canned corn. You might as well stop screaming, crying, and crapping all over yourself, because you're not going to get a toy, mister. Moms are tough. Except at the grocery store checkout line. Sometimes they give in. Because that's when kids really put the pressure on mama. They know that's their last chance to close the deal on something sweet. They start working on mama. Mom. They got chocolate ice cream. Mom. Mom, I got a chocolate ice cream. Maybe you said we could have some chocolate ice cream the next time we came here. Well, is this the next time we're here? Yeah. So it's time to have some chocolate ice cream. That's what you said. You said so. Wouldn't it be great if adults could do that? Go to your boss at work. Buff. Hey, don't mean to bother you, but I've been working here a long time, Warren. Can I get a raise? No. Yeah. Knock the computer off your desk. I'm fired. The boss gives you a spanking. Move your hand. No, leave me alone. Remember that? It wouldn't be weird if bosses could spank their employees from time to time. Change the workplace a little bit. Bob, you want to step into my office for a second? What? What is it? Just step in here. I want to talk to you for a minute. What did I do? I'll take you here. Come on in here. Not till you tell me what I do. Because there would always be one employee that would get into it. Oops, I lost all the computer files. They better spank me. Everything on the hard drive is cleaned out. Spank me hard.
There's always one.
Yes, indeed. Oh, my goodness. Ah, yes. Children and parents. Of course, we were all single at one time. Anybody still single? Any single people? Yeah, here I am. Oh, and he's alone. No problem with that at all. I'm still looking for that one woman I want to spend the rest of my life with. You know, get married, buy a little house, have a couple of kids, get divorced, have a bitter chalk us, get out of living in a small apartment, hang out, want to hang out in singles bars, become an alcoholic, commit a petty crime, spend my twilight years in a halfway house where everybody knows my name. It's not easy for comedians to meet women. I don't think that many women really fantasize about going out with a comic. An old Jerry Lewis image comes to mind. Oh, nice lady! Me and you could do the thing with the hair. It's not that attractive, really. Yeah, I was a bad picker. A bad picker of. Like the last date I went out on, the girl turned out to be an ISIS. You know, a lot of people are saying, you know, that's really bad. ISIS does a lot of bad things. But I don't know, she was really sweet. Talked about her cat. You know, she felt like she'd been radicalized at an early age and wanted to give all that up and stop the beheadings and maybe settle down and have a family. She paid for dinner, so I don't know. I don't know anymore. I tell you what I do know. I know we need more love in this world. Anybody in love? Anybody in love? Clap hands if you love somebody. Even if it's yourself. You know, with all the craziness and the wars and the madness and the insanity going on right now, let's start. Show some love right here, right now in this room. Turn and hug your neighbor. Show some love. Hug your neighbor. Hug your neighbor. Show some love. Now, French kiss your neighbor. French kiss your neighbor. Ding dong, kiss the stranger next to you. Show some love. Except for you. I used to be in love. I used to think money could buy you love, but now I know it's credit. You need really good credit. But I fell in love one time really hard. It wasn't just a little bit of love. It was love, love. I'm talking about head over heels, heart pumping, brain stopping, earth rocking, cloud parting, long letter writing, baby talking, goofy grinning, high and mighty, head in the clouds, slow walking, always talking, no eating, no sleeping, job losing, stop losing, no smoking, weight losing, iron pumping, vitamin taking, poetry writing, hairstyle, apartment cleaning, new clothes buying, age line, all assigned, new age preaching, beach walking, bedroom mining, mountain climbing, bike riding, head crush, diving, 3 feet off the ground, going for broke, hot blooded, too cool for words, as good as it gets, stone cold, blind as a bat. A number one first class storybook, Fool for Love. The real deal. And the first 2 months you're in love is the hard part because you're not yourself the first 2 months. Women act different the first 2 months, they're really nice. Guys can't fart the first 2 months, they hold those in. See them walking on the streets. What's wrong with you? I'm in love, get away from me. Of course, after a couple of years, you can throw up on each other and get away with it. Then you start to learn about her bathroom needs. Women have a lot of bathroom needs, like the toilet lid dilemma, which I will never understand, because when I go into a bathroom, I can see if the toilet lid is up or down, and I adjust it accordingly. What do women do? Stand at the edge of the door in the dark and do like a running backward butt leap for the bowl? You left it up again! Thank you very much. Merry Christmas. Happy New Year, everybody.
That was Greg Travis, and he has a new movie coming out that he started on a long time ago. It is a noir type of a movie. It's called Dark Seduction. It's a gumshoe murder mystery that involves vampires. And you can find him on GT filmproductions.com/dark-seduction. Greg Travis, GT, filmproductions.com. Dark Seduction is coming. They're going to have a world premiere Friday, April 1st at 12 midnight, $11 at NUART Theater on Santa Monica Boulevard in California. And I hope everybody will get a hold of him and support him. It looks great from the trailer. It's tongue-in-cheek. It's meant to entertain you, and it does. It delivers with that. I have to share a little story with you because we have just a few minutes. But when Teddy and I first met, we were able to read books and do things, that people do before they have children and all that. And we were reading books and sitting on the couch, and this really rank smell came through the room. And I looked at him, and he looked at me, and we smiled, and we started reading again. And then it happened again, and I looked at him, and he looked at me, and we smiled, and just kind of, okay, And then it happened a third time. And I looked at him, I says, Teddy, if you need to use the bathroom, go use the bathroom. He looked at me, he says, me? I thought it was you. And all of a sudden, my dog, Gypsy, comes out from under the table with her head hanging low and walks real slow into the bedroom. It was her passing gas, and we broke up laughing. Yeah, for the first couple of months of a relationship, you don't tell the other person all your faults. You're trying to put your best foot forward. There are no hashtags in your underwear. You don't leave anything out that makes you look like a slob in the bathroom. And then all of a sudden, you get used to each other, and that's when things go to hell. Teddy used to have the saying, and I'd never done this. He says, the honeymoon's over when you're doing a shave and your wife comes in and takes a crap while you're in the bathroom. That's when the honeymoon is over. Greg Travis is a great comic. He's a great friend. I wish him the best. Please check him out at gtproductions.com. And if you're in Santa Monica Boulevard area in California, if you can hit it, you're going in for the day, please check him out. Let me make sure I got the date right again. April 1st, 12 midnight, world premiere of Dark Seduction. It is a murder mystery vampire noir movie, and you're going to really enjoy it. It'll be a great time for all. I want to wish everybody a very happy Easter. It's coming. The holy days are coming. Thursday, we have Greg Cope White, the Pink Marine. He's written a book about being gay in the Marines. He's coming on Thursday instead of the Music Box because we needed to fit him in. He has a book out, and it's going to be a really great interview. It is the start of Purim, and then Good Friday after that, and then Easter Sunday. I wish you all, whatever your holidays are, blessed holidays. God bless you and yours, and thank you for tuning in. And with that, I'm going to say good night. Thank you for visiting me at my lair, and God bless you and yours. Ha ha ha.
Ha, 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 ha.